Good afternoon. We start with portfolio questions and question number one from Claudia Beamish.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what its response is to the research suggesting that there is a possible link between Alzheimer's disease and air pollution.
Minister Maureen Watt.
The Scottish Government is aware of the recently published research that suggested a possible link between air pollution and Alzheimer's disease. The Scottish Government receives advice on these issues from public health experts, including Health Protection Scotland and Public Health England, who keep the available evidence on public health risks under constant review. This approach ensures that policy interventions are based on all the available relevant evidence.
Claudia Beamish.
I thank the Minister for that answer. And as she highlights, there's a study led by Public Health Ontario published in The Lancet recently. And this did find that among those who live within 50 metres of a major road, that there is a 1 in 10 cases of dementia could be attributed, and I stress the word could, to traffic exposure. With this new and concerning research coming forward, can the Cabinet Secretary give reassurance that she will work across portfolios to limit air pollution from traffic? And I understand that there are also possible risks from noise, which might be associated as well, particularly for those living and working close to heavy traffic. Thank you.
Minister.
I thank Claudia Beamish for her supplementary. Yes, I am aware of the study on Ontario. I think it was widely publicised, although it was just one piece of research. But as she knows, with her environmental hat on, we are committed to improving air quality across the country, and we have seen significant reductions in pollution emissions over the decades through tighter industrial regulation, improved fuel quality, cleaner vehicles, and increased focus on sustainable transport. We know that there are hotspots where local authorities have a key role in making sure that air quality is up to standard. In relation to the noise aspect, I wasn't aware of that, but I'm happy to look into it. And if I can find anything, I'll let the member know.
Maurice Golden.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Does the Scottish Government have details of the estimated cost to the NHS and wider society costs as a result of air pollution? And if this information is not available, will the Scottish Government commit to a study in this area?
Minister.
Well, all local authorities have plans to deal with air quality management. As a government, we do work across portfolio. The government does provide 2 million of annual funding to local authorities to assist them with the work in making sure that air quality is up to standards. So I can assure the member that we do work across portfolios to ensure that the risks are minimised.
Mark Ruskell.
Thank you, and can I declare an interest as a councillor in Stirling? Is the Minister concerned, as I am, that increasing numbers of councils are making decisions on developments which will actually worsen air quality, often in spite of recommendations from directors of public health to reject those developments? There's a particular issue in Perth with the Scone development, 700 houses objected to by the head of public health at NHS Tayside, but nevertheless has now been approved, despite the fact it will make the air quality issues around Bridge End in Perth substantially worse. What will you do to ensure that we can join up health and planning?
I thank the member for his question. I think it's perhaps more a question to the planning minister, and there is a debate on planning tomorrow, and I think he's announced a review of planning, which I think it would be wise for the member to feed his concerns into.
Colin Smith.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Recent figures for dementia post-diagnostic support has shown that only 17% of those living in the least or the most deprived areas are referred for such support, compared to 24% in the more affluent areas. I'm sure the Minister will agree both figures are shockingly low. So can I ask, what action is the Government taking to ensure that everyone with a diagnosis of dementia receives the care they require?
Minister.
Thank the member for that question, and I'm glad to see the figures published yesterday, which give us a true picture of those in need of dementia care. Of course, Scotland is the first country in the UK to have the support of a one-year post-diagnostic support. The dementia strategy is being reviewed at the moment, and you members can look forward to a new dementia strategy shortly, which will take that into account.
Question number two, Ash Denham.
To ask the Scottish Government what action it's taking to reduce health inequalities in mothers during pregnancy and also into the postnatal period.
Minister Aileen Campbell.
Action from the Scottish Government and the NHS boards has meant women are now accessing maternity care earlier in their pregnancy, with over 80% having their antenatal booking appointment by 12 weeks gestation. This is across all SIMD quintiles. Last week, we published the review of all maternity and neonatal services developed around what women and families tell us they want, with a number of recommendations focusing on inequalities. In the spring, we will roll out free vitamins to all pregnant women. This is something no other country in the UK has committed to. And from this summer, every child born in Scotland will receive a baby box, a box of essential items to help level the playing field for every family. We've also invested more than £11.2 million from 2011 to health boards to promote breastfeeding and to support women to breastfeed for as long as they wish to do. We are the first in the UK to have 100% of our maternity units accredited by the UNICEF Baby Friendly Initiative. And we are providing funding for an additional 500 health visitors and have introduced a new enhanced universal service with key child health reviews, in addition to offering the Family Nurse Partnership Programme to all eligible teenage mothers by the end of 2018. These measures are just an example of our ambition to give children the very best start in life, regardless of income.
Ash Denham.
I thank the Minister for that answer. Reducing health inequalities obviously is one of the biggest challenges we're facing, and creating a culture in which healthy behaviours become the norm should start at the very earliest years. Can the Minister outline what the Scottish Government is doing to ensure that health outcomes for children are improved and inequalities are reduced?
Reducing inequalities, including those around health, is a key part of the Government's aims. With our partners, we support a wide range of activity to address this. As I've mentioned, Family Nurse Partnership, Universal Pathway for Health Visiting, the increased numbers of health visitors, support for breastfeeding, free vitamins for pregnant women are just a few. But we also address wider issues which impact health, including child poverty and our aspirations for raising attainment. Finally, I agree that the early years are crucial, as is early intervention and prevention, and we continue to strive to achieve our aims of getting it right for every child. And of course, the rollout of early learning and childcare will also play a part in the ambitions that we have for our children.
Monica Lennon.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. One of the best possible ways to achieve better outcomes for babies who are born premature or sick is to ensure that parents are able to spend time with their baby for long interrupted periods and take the lead in the delivery of their care. The Bliss Scotland baby report, which I know that the Cabinet Secretary attended the reception last night, has quite shocking findings that only 3 out of 12 units have dedicated accommodation for parents of critically ill babies. And last night, after the Cabinet Secretary left the reception, we heard from Cody, whose baby was delivered at 29 weeks. And in her local hospital, there was only one room for parents to stay overnight. What specific action will the government take to prevent the trauma of separation between mother and baby and to reduce the pressure on neonatal units?
Minister.
I thank Monica Lennon for her supplementary. We have, as I've mentioned in my response to Ash Denham, have published a review of all maternity and neonatal services, and that's been developed around what women and families have told us that they want. And of course, some of the things that you've pointed out will have been part of that engagement process, and that sets out a comprehensive package of things that we can do to improve on the services that we have across the country. But I think it's also important to remember that what we will be doing is building on a position of strength and of the great work that's happening right across our NHS. There is a number of recommendations around what we should be doing around our neonatal, and we're working hard now to implement those recommendations and work hard to bring even greater improvements to services right across our country.
Alison Johnson.
Thank you. I welcome the Government's positive response to Scottish Greens' calls for a rollout of the Healthier, Wealthier Children Scheme, which is very effective addressing the health inequalities we're discussing here. Can the Government give Parliament some information regarding implementation and the timescale for that rollout? Thank you.
Minister.
We'll commit to updating Alison Johnson, and we'll write to her with some of the specific details that she seeks. However, I would also again point out to her, as I think we've also had cause to do in many discussions and debates in Parliament around the work on the Early Years Collaborative, which isn't just about what's happening in Glasgow, but the work across the country that people are taking forward to improve and maximise income, and working with local authorities and others to make sure that income maximisation is part of the holistic support that is offered to children and to families in those crucial and important early years.
Question number three, Gail Ross.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what steps it is taking to recruit physicians and surgeons for rural general hospitals.
Cabinet Secretary Shona Robertson.
NHS Scotland boards are required to have the correct staff in place to meet the needs of the service and ensure high quality patient care. The Scottish Government works closely with boards to support their efforts in staff recruitment. There are a range of actions that are already being taken to support boards to recruit in remote and rural areas from abroad, and also to encourage those who trained or worked in NHS Scotland to return and work in the health service. We'll continue to look at how we can build on this.
Gail Ross.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer. She will be aware, and indeed I've been told by NHS Highland on numerous occasions, that the very nature of rural general hospitals means that general surgeons are required. And this goes against the trend in recent years for surgeons to specialise in a particular field. What can be done to encourage trainee surgeons not to specialise and have a broader range of experience and training?
Sorry, Cabinet Secretary.
Well, Gail Ross makes a very important point, and I think the longer term solution lies in implementing the recommendations from the Shape of Training report to achieve a better balance between general and specialist medical skills. And working with the surgical colleges, proposals are well advanced for a revised training curriculum that will equip trainees with the competencies to deliver elective and emergency general surgery in a district general hospital setting. And trainees who complete the programme successfully will become consultant general surgeons. As changes impact across the UK, health ministers from across the nations will soon be invited to approve implementation of that. I think this will help very much to enable our district general hospitals and rural general hospitals to recruit and retain the staff that they require to deliver services.
Anas Sarwar.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The Cabinet Secretary will no doubt heard Dr. Peter Benny of the BMA's interview, where he spoke quite candidly about being fed up of the mantra of government that there were more doctors than ever before, when the actual question should be, are there enough doctors, are there enough nurses, are there enough staff? And given the challenges in all areas, but particularly also in rural areas, can the Cabinet Secretary tell us what impact she believes the offering of 9-1 contracts to consultants rather than 8-2 contracts is having in terms of attracting consultants to come up to Scotland to practice medicine?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, we work very closely with the BMA, and indeed there's a meeting with the BMA next week. One of the issues is around the balance of the consultant contract. That does vary within boards and across boards, and I'll continue to discuss with the BMA how we take that forward. But on the point of how do we ensure that we continue to deliver enough doctors to deliver a quality service that we have here in Scotland. And of course, we have taken action not only to expand the number of undergraduate medical places and indeed to improve access to those medical places so we can have a more diverse medical workforce. But of course, we will be opening Scotland's first new graduate medical school in due course, which will help to ensure an even greater supply of doctors for the service for the future.
Edward Mountain.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Will the Cabinet Secretary agree with me that the huge cuts in NHS Highland budget highlighted today on the front page of the Press and Journal will lead to the NHS Highland continuing their centralisation of services to Ragmore Hospital, which will lead to the absolute detriment and destruction of our rural hospitals?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, in contrast to that, the NHS revenue budget will increase by £500 million over inflation over the course of this Parliament. And, of course, in 2017-18, funding for our core NHS budgets will increase by over £320 million, more than the Barnett consequentials for health of £304 million. We're investing £128 million in territorial boards over the course of next year in delivering services, and NHS Highland will benefit from that investment and they will get an uplift of 1.5%, but also, importantly, a share of the £50 million NRAC funding. So I can assure Edwin McMountain that more investment is going to enter NHS, but as always, efficiency savings will be required in order to deliver some of the changes that are required, and all of that money is invested back into frontline services.
Tavish Scott.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Further to Gail Ross's point about specific GPs and consultants for rural general hospitals, would the Cabinet Secretary go back to the idea that was, in fairness, posed in the past about looking at ways in which key staff could be retained for such hospitals post-graduation, following the very significant investment that Parliament and Government vote and support them through that process?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, there are a number of recruitment and retention measures available to boards to try and recruit and retain staff, particularly those staff that are in key specialties that are more difficult to recruit. So, you know, we are keen to work with boards to look at what more can be done. I think part of the solution, in addition to the training changes that will deliver a very, very important change to the role of staff, the idea of having that general surgeon is going to be very, very important for our district and our rural general hospitals. But also the idea and concept of doctors particularly working across a network of hospitals, so that they may spend part of their time working in a teaching hospital, part of their time working within a rural general or district general, and that makes the post far more attractive. Tavish Scott will also be aware of the range of activity we're taking forward to address some of the gaps within general practice, particularly within rural areas.
And Kate Forbes.
Thank you. Is the Cabinet Secretary aware of the situation in the Belford Hospital in Fort William, which has lost three rural general surgeons through a series of very unfortunate events, leaving the hospital struggling for general surgeons? And would she work with NHS Highland to ensure that there are replacement general surgeons?
Cabinet Secretary.
Yes, I am aware of these challenges, and our health and social care delivery plan published in December recognises that we need services that have the capacity, focus and workforce to continue to address the pressures of a changing society and an ageing population, and those key priorities are set out in the delivery plan. A key driver for this, of course, will be our National Health and Social Care Workforce Plan, which will be published in the spring of this year. NHS Highland is already looking at ways to make better use of the available workforce and work across traditional site boundaries, which I was referring to in response to Tavish Scott. So all of these measures will be very important in bringing a stability, but also to help some of our rural general hospitals being able to recruit and retain their staff.
Question number four, David Torrance.
To ask the Scottish Government what the funding uplift will be for NHS Fife in 2017 to 2018.
Cabinet Secretary.
NHS Fife will receive a baseline uplift of 1.5%, taking resource funding for 2017-18 to £616.2 million. This follows the Scottish Government's draft budget for 2017-18 is set out in Parliament on the 15th of December last year. The draft budget doesn't include the Board's share of £50 million of additional NRAC funding, which, subject to parliamentary approval, will be confirmed as part of the 2017-18 budget bill.
David Turner.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer. Of NHS Fife's budget, what proportion will be used to support the integration of health and social care in 2017-18?
Cabinet Secretary.
Health boards are currently setting their budgets for 17-18, and NHS Fife have yet to finalise their figures for next year. However, we estimate that their recurrent budget in 2017-18 will be £616 million, as I set out in my initial answer, and that the Scottish Government requirement is that the allocation to integration authorities from health boards must be at least equal to their 2016-17 recurrent budget allocation. So for NHS Fife, this figure was £338 million. And so we estimate that around 55% of NHS Fife's 2017-18 budget will be delegated to the Fife Partnership to support the integration of health and social care.
Question number five, Christina McKelvey.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what action it is taking to encourage young people's participation in badminton.
Minister Aileen Campbell.
Since the success of Scottish badminton players at the Glasgow 2014 Commonwealth Games, we have seen a steady increase in people playing the sport. For instance, since the Games, the Active Schools programme has seen an increase of over 2% in participant sessions, with a total of over 292,000 sessions through 2015-16. Sport Scotland, the national agency for sport, is investing up to £2.9 million into Badminton Scotland for the 2015-19 investment cycle, a 2.7% increase from the 2011-15 funding cycle. In addition, through Visit Scotland's Events Directorate, the Scottish Government is supporting the Badminton World Championships being staged at Glasgow's Emirates Arena in August this year. Badminton Scotland plans to get 30,000 more schoolchildren playing the game through their Big Hit festivals as part of the legacy programme built around the championships.
Christina McKelvey.
Can I thank the Minister for some of that detail and ask her if she's got any thoughts on the fact that it was recently announced that badminton was to be one of the five sports to lose all UK sports funding for the 2020 Olympics in Tokyo. And she will know that Hamilton Sports Council has supported many young people to take up and become champions in sport, not least her own very successful badminton star, Kirsty Gilmer, who raised some concerns about the UK funding cut recently. Can the Minister tell us what support Sports Scotland currently gives to her current and possible sports star of the future so that we don't lose this talent?
Minister.
I thank Christina McKelvey for raising this issue and for, again, giving us a chance to congratulate Kirsty on all the achievements that she has had through her career. Sport Scotland has developed a world-class sporting system at all levels, connecting sport and schools and education, club and community sport and performance sport. For instance, Sport Scotland is investing £50 million over the period 2015-19 in its Active Schools programme, which provides opportunities for children to try sports and begin that path towards becoming sports stars of the future. And I'll continue to engage with Christina McKelvey on any issues that she would like to continue to raise around badminton, particularly with given her local interest in Kirsty's career.
Brian Whittle.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I've got to say I find it rather hypocritical for the member to be raising this issue and it's her government that proposes to slash the sports budget by some £4 million. Sports Scotland have indicated in the Health and Sports Committee there will be significant repercussions in the number of sports it will be able to support and the value of that support. How does the Scottish Government propose to mitigate against its own slashing cuts?
Minister.
Again, I don't doubt Brian Whittle's commitment to sport, and I don't think anyone can compete in terms of his first-hand knowledge and experience of sport, no matter how much of us across the chamber enjoy and experience sport ourselves. But I think to add to his gold medal should be a brass neck in terms of the devastating blows that his party has hit on our poorest communities through welfare reforms and austerity. My party and this government has to soften those blows and alongside remains absolutely committed to sport and activity, building on the legacy of our 2014 Games, empowering our communities and maximising the use of the significant investment and improvement that we have made in our facilities right across the length and breadth of this country.
Question number six, Emma Harper.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what steps it takes to ensure that the health advice it produces is accessible to people with hearing loss and deafness.
Cabinet, sorry, Minister Maureen Watt.
The patient charter clearly sets out what patients can expect when they use NHS Scotland services and receive care. This includes the right to be given the information they need in a format or language they can understand. Under the Equality Act 2010, NHS Scotland is required to provide translation and interpreting services and written material wherever possible and reasonable. All the NHS boards have a published accessibility policy and arrangements in place to support such needs. People who are deaf or who are hard of hearing can access Scotland's National Health and Information Service, NHS Inform, using the Contact Scotland VSL service or by text phone and through web chat, which is available on the NHS Inform website.
Emma Harper.
I thank the Minister for her answer. Does she agree with me that taking steps such as subtitling government videos is important to ensuring that people with deafness are able to fully benefit from health advice?
Minister.
I would fully agree with Emma Harper and would assure her that the Scottish Government is committed to providing health information in formats that are accessible to people with hearing loss and deafness. All Scottish Government campaign websites are tested for accessibility as standard, and subtitles are added to videos that are placed on YouTube. In addition, all reasonable efforts are made to ensure the top level and main contact pages on the Scottish Government website are compliant with worldwide consortium standards, which cover a range of disabilities, including auditory. And NHS 24 is currently working with partners to ensure that videos displayed on the new NHS Inform website have the language option, including BSL and subtitles, as seen on the Care Information Scotland website.
Miles Briggs.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The BDA Scotland Health Review 2016 said that people with hearing loss found communication was easiest in local primary care services, which they were familiar with, but more difficult in a secondary care setting. What plans do ministers have to improve healthcare for deaf people, specifically within a secondary care setting?
Minister.
Well, as I said in my previous answer, people with impairments should be able to access that. It is a case of making sure that before a person goes to secondary care, that the letter that goes with the patient asking for the appointment is fully understands that the person may have a hearing loss or whatever. And these sorts of things are being worked on as a result of the BSL legislation that was put through this Parliament.
Question number 7, John Mason.
Thank you. To ask the Scottish Government what its position is on GP practices in the most deprived areas receiving more resources per patient than those in the less deprived areas.
Cabinet Secretary.
Tackling health inequalities is one of our primary care outcomes, as recently published in a joint memorandum with the BMA. Adjusting the Scottish allocation formula, which weights general practice funding by various factors that affect workload, not least deprivation, is one way that could help deliver that outcome. We also need to look beyond the GP contract to other interventions and ways of supporting general practice in areas of high deprivation, which is why this government has committed to increasing the number of link workers supporting general practice in Scotland.
John Mason.
Thank the Cabinet Secretary for that reply. I mean, I think the BMA is in a difficult position that it's representing both GPs in rich areas and in poor areas. And I do wonder if we don't need to put more emphasis on the deep end practices and those in the poorer areas, because they are dealing with much greater health needs and multi-morbidity, and they really need to spend a lot more time with individual patients.
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, John Mason makes a fair point, but I'm confident that we can get agreement with the BMA around making sure that there is a good, solid recognition of deprivation in terms of the resources that are allocated to those practices operating in our most deprived communities. And of course, deprivation is one factor which increases demand upon GP resources, and therefore the Scottish allocation formula is weighted to help practices in deprived areas. We're investing in projects such as the Deep End Pioneer Scheme to try and support GPs working in very deprived areas, in addition, of course, to our investment in primary care more generally, with an additional £500 million being invested over the course of this Parliament, meaning that there will be a big shift in NHS frontline spending to our community and primary health services. The Scottish allocation formula is under review and has been reviewed, and of course we are commissioning a further review into GP pay and expenses, and all of this alongside the renegotiation of the contract I think will help to address some of John Mason's concerns.
Joanne Lamond.
Thank you. I wonder if I can emphasise to the Cabinet Secretary concerns that the current formula for GPs in deprived areas has an unintended consequence that they have less time to meet and talk and work with needy patients. And what certainly the doctor said to me was that the link worker thing may be part of the process, but they were concerned the current funding means that they have less time to spend, but they can give people drugs when in fact they don't need tablets. What they do need is somebody who can understand properly what their condition is. Would the government minister make a commitment to look again at how this can be taken forward? Because it's a genuinely bizarre situation where those doctors who are under most pressure are less well funded.
Cabinet Secretary.
Oh, let me reassure Joanne Lamont, because I know it is an issue she's raised a number of times in this chamber. Let me reassure her that as part of our negotiations with the BMA, as I've said, the Scottish allocation formula has been reviewed. We are commissioning a further review into GP pay and expenses because we need to understand more of the detail around that in coming to some of the contractual agreements. What I would say to Joanne Lamont as well, though, is that in addition to the formula and the contract, there is a lot of work that is generally geared towards addressing workload issues, which will help those GPs working in deprived communities as well as GPs generally, and being able to ensure that they have more time to spend with those patients with more complex issues, I think will probably have a more positive beneficial effect for those GPs working in deprived communities, because many of those patients will be those with complex multi-morbidity issues that need more time spent on them. Just on the link worker issue, I met with a link worker down in East Ayrshire who is attached to a GP practice, and what was very, very clear is that the importance of making sure that the GPs are able, through that link worker, to connect the patient into local services, whether that's mental health services or other services. And I'm absolutely convinced that that role will make a tremendous difference to helping make sure patients get to the right place.
Donald Cameron.
Thank you. The Cabinet Secretary mentioned the financial commitments to primary care, but there does remain a lack of clarity as to where that will be targeted. Given the chair of the Royal College of GPs, Dr. Miles Mack, said that this is an opportunity to lessen the effects of the inverse care law, under which those most in need of healthcare have least access to it, will the Cabinet Secretary today give details as to where those sums will be targeted?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, first of all, let me just reiterate that next financial year we will be investing £72 million in improvements to primary care and GP services, but that is against a backdrop of a commitment to an additional £500 million being invested over the course of this Parliament. That is a huge shift in investment, something that I would hope the member would welcome. In terms of where that money is spent and the priorities, we have set out the priorities for reducing workload, improving recruitment and retention, building those multidisciplinary teams that will be able to work together, seeing patients, helping patients, with the GP as a clinical expert supporting that team. That is a model that has the support of the BMA and indeed, I believe, the RCGP as well. So I'm very happy to continue to provide detail as we take these issues forward, but this is a big transformation in the way primary care is delivered, but one I think that will be very much to be the benefit of patients.
Question number 8, Richard Lyle.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what action it is taking to encourage more participation in sporting activities.
Minister Eileen Campbell.
Thank you. The Scottish Government is committed to increasing rates of physical activity, with participation in sport a key element of that. The Active Scotland Outcomes Framework sets out our ambitions for a more active Scotland and is underpinned by a commitment to equality, making sure that regardless of gender, age, sexuality or income, there are opportunities and support to encourage people to be active.
Richard Lyle.
Can I thank the Minister for that answer, and I welcome the work being done. 2017 will mark 3 years on from the Glasgow 2014 Commonwealth Games and the legacy which we sought to create. Can I therefore ask what action the Scottish Government has been taking and will continue to take in delivering community sports hubs across Scotland that will continue building on the legacy of our 2014 Games?
Minister.
I'm delighted to say that through the investment by Sports Scotland that there already are 157 community hubs, sports hubs up and running right across Scotland, and this will further increase to 200 by 2020, providing more and better opportunities for people of all ages and abilities to be active. Sports Scotland is currently focusing on 7 community sports hubs across 5 local authorities in the 5% most deprived areas, and providing additional support to help enhance their local offer, develop existing and new opportunities to grow membership and explore barriers to school, clubs and participation.
Question number 9, Jenny Mara.
To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide the £90 million required to bring the electrical wiring at Ninewells Hospital up to safe and modern standards.
Cabinet Secretary.
NHS Tayside is currently developing a long-term investment plan for Ninewells Hospital, which includes work to ensure the resilience of the electrical infrastructure of the site. They are in the process of developing the business case for this project, and it will be submitted to the NHS Capital Investment Group for consideration in the coming weeks. A decision on the funding will be made once the business case has been reviewed. While this plan is being developed, there is continual maintenance across the Ninewells site and ongoing investment in the site's infrastructure to ensure NHS Tayside can continue to deliver high quality, sustainable and safe service delivery for their patients.
Jenny Mara.
Cabinet Secretary for her answer. She'll know as well as I do that NHS Tayside is running a projected deficit this year of £18 million, that they have millions of pounds of debt to this government and no obvious way to repay it. In light of this and Audit Scotland's warnings about NHS Tayside finances, will she pledge to fully fund the £90 million bill so we can make sure that electrical wiring at Ninewells Hospital is safe for patients?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, first of all, on the issue of the deficit of NHS Tayside, which has obviously been subject to a lot of public scrutiny, not least from Jenny Mara's own committee, what is clear is that the Scottish Government will continue to work with NHS Tayside in helping them to deliver a sustainable plan to recover their financial position. But if Jenny Mara had listened to my initial answer, she would have heard very clearly that a decision on the funding will be made following review of the business case. That's how we do things. We get a proper business case from a board, we then review it, and we take that forward. So it wouldn't be appropriate to make any decision before that review is complete. That's the proper way to make investment decisions. And we recognise the importance of Ninewells having a reliable and safe electrical infrastructure. And officials at the Scottish Government have been working with NHS Tayside as they develop their case. I would have thought, given I said that would happen in the next few weeks, that might be something Jenny Mara might welcome.
Liam Kerr.
But clearly not.
Deputy Presiding Officer, 10 days ago, NHS Tayside took a decision to close the dedicated mental health unit, the Mulberry unit at Stracathrow Hospital, which is the only adult psychiatric admissions ward in Angus, because only 18 whole-time junior doctors from a requirement of 31 are available to NHS Tayside. What is the government actively doing to recruit more mental health doctors, and when will NHS Tayside have enough resource to reopen the Mulberry unit?
In this case, although it's the question is valid, it's not a supplementary to a question about Ninewells and electrical wiring. So we'll take question number 10, Mary Fee.
Thank you. To ask the Scottish Government when it will next meet NHS Greater Glasgow and Clyde.
Cabinet Secretary Shona Robison.
Ministers and Scottish Government officials regularly meet with representatives of all health boards, including NHS Greater Glasgow and Clyde.
Mary Fee.
As the Health Secretary will know, a campaign group of strong and committed parents has been set up to oppose the closure of Ward 15 at the RAH in Paisley. We heard last week that a young boy from Paisley, Alex Gray, had to be diverted to Edinburgh because of lack of beds at the new Children's Hospital in Glasgow. Can I ask the Health Secretary if she thinks the closure of Ward 15 should go ahead, given the new Children's Hospital couldn't take this one child, never mind an estimated 8,000 additional cases that are to be transferred from the RAH to Glasgow? And can the Health Secretary tell us whether she intends to visit Paisley at any point to listen to the views of local parents?
Cabinet Secretary.
So, first of all, I think it's important that we understand what the paediatric intensive care service is. It's a service that's operated as a single national service, delivered from two units in Edinburgh and Glasgow since 2007. These are highly specialised facilities with very skilled clinical teams. Now, clearly, it's important that those beds are managed on a Scotland-wide basis and that children will get to the right place when they require that bed. And that sometimes means if there are no beds available in Glasgow, that children would go to Edinburgh or vice versa. But those beds are managed, they're very specialist beds and are managed on a national basis. And it's important not to conflate the issue with Ward 15 at the RAH, because that does not have any paediatric intensive care beds. Children could not be treated in those beds if they have that level of need. So the two issues are very, very different. But in regard to Ward 15 at the RAH, they were designated by the board, as Mary Fee knows full well, as major, currently out to formal public consultation until the 6th of February. And I would certainly encourage all stakeholders to register their views. It would be inappropriate for me to comment any further at this point, except to say, of course, that those final proposals will be subject to ministerial approval, and I'll carefully consider all the available information and representations before coming to a final decision.
Can I thank you? We're tight for time this afternoon, so we'll move on to the next item of business, which is a statement by Michael Russell on the UK Supreme Court judgment on the triggering of Article 50. The Minister will take questions at the end of his statement, so there should be no interventions while he's speaking. And if members wish to ask a question, however, they may press their request to speak buttons whenever they wish to do so.